His name was Tim Couch. He was the first would-be savior of the new Cleveland Browns. Long before Cleveland became known as the final resting place for NFL quarterbacks, Couch was expected to carry the torch from the likes of Otto Graham, Brian Sipe, and Bernie Kosar. He was supposed to revitalize a city that lost their football team just 4 years back. But for one reason or another, it did not work out. Tim Couch would last just 5 short seasons in Cleveland and retire from the NFL shortly after. As a result, many consider Couch to be nothing more than a bust, while others say he wasn't given a fair shake. But what really happened? What is Tim Couch's legacy in the NFL? Stay tuned for this Tim Couch, a retrospective.
With the first pick in the 1999 draft, the Cleveland Browns selection is from the University of Kentucky, quarterback Tim Couch.
After months of speculation, the front office of the new Cleveland Browns decided to draft Kentucky's Tim Couch with the number one overall pick. To them, this was a no-brainer. They needed a quarterback to be the face of Cleveland's brand new football team, and who better to fill that void than Tim Couch? Couch had been a standout at Kentucky, playing in the highly competitive Southeastern Conference. In 1998, he was awarded SEC Player of the Year. On top of that, he helped bring Kentucky's lackluster football program back to respectability. The Browns' original plan for Tim Couch was to have him sit out his first season and learn the game behind veteran quarterback Ty Detmer. At that point, Detmer was a 7-year journeyman, so he appeared to be a perfect mentor for young Tim Couch. So the plan was set, and the wheels were in motion. But then came the first preseason game, which also happened to be the Hall of Fame game. The Browns were playing the Cowboys, and Tim Couch had his first chance to show the world what he was made of. He ended up doing very well, and the Browns squeaked out a win in overtime. Yes, a preseason game actually went to overtime. Now this takes us to the season opener. Cleveland was playing their arch-rival Pittsburgh on ESPN's Sunday Night Football. It was the perfect setting for the Browns to make their return to the NFL. Unfortunately, it turned out to be a disastrous night for the Browns. They finished with only 2 first downs and 40 yards of total offense. It was so bad that the Browns decided to abandon their long-term plan for Tim Couch. They threw him into the game at the start of the fourth quarter, which turned out to be not such a good idea. His first pass was intercepted, and to be honest, it perfectly summed up the entire night for the Browns. The Steelers ended up thrashing them 43-0. It was a harsh welcome to the NFL moment for both Tim Couch and the new Browns. Cleveland ended up further abandoning their original plan for Couch. After the game, head coach Chris Palmer announced that Couch would be the starter going forward. Many doubted this decision, but at the end of the day, it was the coach's call, so that was all that mattered. It definitely wasn't going to be an easy ride for Tim Couch. Their next opponent was the Tennessee Titans. Couch ended up getting sacked 7 times in the game, 3 of which were by standout defensive end Javon Kearse. The next 5 games would be much of the same, and it turned out Cleveland would have to wait until Week 8 to get their first win of the season. The Browns were down in New Orleans taking on the Saints, and with 2 seconds left, it looked like the Browns were going to chalk up another loss and fall to 0-8 on the year. It was an unbelievable finish, and probably the most memorable first win an expansion team could possibly have. The good news is the Browns wouldn't have to wait long for their next win. It would come just 2 weeks later in Pittsburgh. Cleveland went toe-to-toe with a team that humiliated them in Week 1. Tim Couch and the Browns did their job, and left it up to Phil Dawson to win the game.
4 seconds, 3 seconds, ball placed down, the kick is up, the kick is down the middle, the kick's good! The Browns have beaten the Steelers in Pittsburgh!
Sadly, that would be about the last positive to come out of the 1999 season. The Browns finished with a dismal 2-14 record. But I look at it this way. When your two wins are a walk-off Hail Mary and a last-second field goal against the Steelers, that's about the best 2-14 season you could ask for. But in all seriousness, there wasn't much to celebrate about the year. Tim Couch ended up getting sacked a whopping 56 times, and he later admitted the bumps and bruises he took his rookie season severely diminished his confidence. But all the negativity aside, Couch still managed to put up respectable numbers. He finished with 15 touchdowns and 13 interceptions, while completing 56% of his passes. Now this takes us to the 2000 season, which started off very promising for the Browns. They jumped out with a 2-1 record, and both of their wins were against division rivals. In week 2, they beat the Bengals down in Cincinnati. And in week 3, they beat the Steelers back at Cleveland Browns Stadium. The Steelers game turned out to be memorable for one reason.
Gardocki, wobbly kick. Gardocki getting leveled. Take another look. I think it's Joey Porter, 55, coming back, punch down the field, take a shot, and this is legal. But boy, when you're a starting linebacker, you don't need to take shots at the punter. You throw at one guy, get ready the next inning when that pitcher comes out under the mound.
And look at that.
But what was also noteworthy was the play of Tim Couch. He threw for over 300 yards with 2 touchdowns and no interceptions, and the Browns went on to win 23-20, marking their second straight win over Pittsburgh. Unfortunately, that was about the last positive thing to come from the 2000 season. Couch would suffer a season-ending thumb injury in Week 7, and the Browns' season quickly spiraled out of control, losing 11 of their last 12 games. Before Couch got hurt, he put up 7 touchdowns to 9 interceptions, with a completion percentage of 63. Though his touchdown to interception ratio was not great, his completion percentage was right where it needed to be. But overall, Couch's sophomore season in the NFL was another bump in the road. Because the Browns posted another terrible record in 2000, head coach Chris Palmer would lose his job. He finished with a record of 5-27 in 2 years, so a change needed to be made. Now here's where the Tim Couch story gets interesting.
Good for team unity. Not bad for bloodlust either. Will Davis be a part of that team unity next year? Rumors have him talking with the Cleveland Browns, but
Butch Davis would become the 10th head coach in Cleveland Browns history. Davis came from the University of Miami, where he had great success, nearly leading them to a national championship. At the time, he was one of the hottest coaches in the college ranks, so him coming to Cleveland was a big deal. I should also mention that had Butch Davis turned down the Browns, Ravens defensive coordinator Marvin Lewis would have become the next head coach in Cleveland. But that's a story for another day. So Butch Davis was now steering the ship in Cleveland, and at the top of his priority list was helping to get the best out of Tim Couch, because the franchise was only going to go as far as he took them. But instead, it seemed Butch Davis was the answer to all of Cleveland's problems. In his first year, he completely changed the narrative with the Browns. They finished with a record of 7-9, and had it not been for some bizarre losses, they may have very well made the playoffs. But we still shouldn't forget about Tim Couch. Looking back, he accomplished something that is extraordinary for a Browns quarterback. He started all 16 games of the season. In fact, he is the last Cleveland quarterback to accomplish that feat. Unfortunately, the rest of his statistics would not follow suit. His completion percentage would dip a little, and he would throw 21 interceptions compared to 17 touchdowns. But even though his numbers weren't the greatest in 2001, they weren't awful. And by starting all 16 games, he at least appeared to be bringing some stability to the quarterback position. Now let's segue to 2002. This is the season the Tim Couch story would take an unexpected turn. Because of an injury before the year, Couch would have to sit out the first 2 games in 2002. That meant veteran Kelly Holcomb would start in his place. Unfortunately for Couch, Holcomb ended up playing lights out in those 2 games. He threw for over 500 yards and tossed 5 touchdowns, and he would have been 2-0 had it not been for a bizarre ending in Week 1. So just like that, a quarterback controversy was born. But Butch Davis would still end up starting Tim Couch in Week 3, much to the dismay of the fans. And for 3.5 quarters in Week 3, the fans' feelings were justified. The Browns were down 14 to the Titans late in the fourth quarter, and the game appeared to be over. But Tim Couch would pull a rabbit out of the hat and lead the Browns to a miraculous come-from-behind victory. But he couldn't recreate that magic the following week. The Browns ended up losing a tough one at Pittsburgh. And that sets the stage for perhaps the darkest moment of Tim Couch's career.
Conversion. Bad snap. Couch has got to chase it down, and they'll mark it at about the 1 yard line.
Couch is hurt. Couch has got a knee on about the 2 yard line, and they spin him around and then just nail him.
Tim Couch very slow to get to his feet. They have taken him out of the ball game.
Dive on the ball and got hit in the back of the head, and next thing I remember, you know, the fans were cheering when I'm laying on the field hurt, and I think it's to be honest with you, but hey, they got their own opinion, so they don't like me. Then been here going on 4 years now, and I've laid it on the line for this team and this city, and for them to turn on me and boo me in my home stadium is a joke. It's a joke to me, and I've worked my ass off here, and it's hard to take, man. It is. And
after Bottlegate the year before, having something like this happen only further damaged the image of Cleveland fans. However, it should be noted that Couch also received thousands of letters from fans saying they supported him. But despite that unsettling event, Couch went on to have arguably the best season of his career. It was a season filled with many wild finishes. The Browns ended up clinching a playoff berth during the final week in 2002, capping off an incredible run. But it turned out Tim Couch would not be a part of that playoff game. In a cruel twist of fate, he ended up breaking his leg in the final week of the season. It was an extremely unfortunate event, but in a way was kind of a microcosm of his entire NFL career. Because of Couch's injury, Kelly Holcomb would once again start in his place. The Browns were taking on the Steelers in the wildcard round of the playoffs, but they would end up falling short. Kelly Holcomb was still a bright spot, however. He absolutely lit it up, throwing for over 400 yards and tossing 3 touchdowns. Of course, this only added more fuel to the fire that was the quarterback controversy. And that brings us to 2003. Because Kelly Holcomb played so well in the playoff game, he was becoming more and more of a fan favorite. Fans were really clamoring for him to become the full-time starter. But it wasn't going to be handed to him. He would have to fight for the starting job in training camp with Tim Couch. The two appeared to be very evenly matched, but Butch Davis would end up giving the nod to Holcomb. That meant Holcomb was going to start week one against the Colts. But it was almost as if the football gods punished the Browns for making that decision. They ended up losing on a last-second field goal. After losing in week two as well, Holcomb finally got the Browns a win in week three, but he would suffer a devastating blow in the process. He broke his leg in the first quarter. This of course meant the Browns would be going back to Tim Couch, and Couch would have another chance to win over his team and the fans. Unfortunately for Couch, the Browns would lose to the Bengals in his first game back. But this wound up setting the stage for one of the biggest moments in Tim Couch's career.
A perfect night for football in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. The 2-2 Steelers against the 1-3 Browns in one of the most bitter rivalries you can find anywhere.
Watch the throw, too. You want to talk about putting the ball. Nice job against Washington getting on top. Sets the corner. Look at that ball drop in. You couldn't throw it any better than Tim Couch threw that.
Will not have to run another play.
Tim Couch had beaten the Steelers for the third time in his career, and he looked phenomenal doing so. As you would imagine, his performance once again stirred up the quarterback controversy. But it would be a game at New England in Week 8 where we would really see the main difference between the two quarterbacks.
And here come the Cleveland Browns offense. Tim Couch gets the call to start at quarterback today. Four wide of the Browns. They have four outstanding wide receivers. Couch running for his life. Sacked from behind. His 53rd NFL spark. Third and five, and Couch can't get it off. Is it a fumble? Kelly Holcomb now running the show in his seventh year out of Middle Tennessee. At halftime. And for that, a treat for the Cleveland fans. Holcomb gets away somehow and fires it out to Hyden. This would be a very long field goal. Flag is down. Holcomb complete. It's Dennis Northcutt. Good protection. Over the middle, complete to Davis.
But Kelly Holcomb is getting rid of the football. And if there's one big difference between he and Tim Couch, it is the fact that Kelly Holcomb is going to get back in the pocket, identify someone in a hurry, and get rid of the football.
If it wasn't clear before, it was clear now. The main difference between Couch and Holcomb was that Couch had a tendency to hold onto the ball too long, which was a big reason he took so many sacks in his career. Holcomb, on the other hand, would get rid of the ball much quicker, which is probably a reason many fans preferred him over Couch. So those were the main differences between Tim Couch and Kelly Holcomb, at least from my perspective. Holcomb would go on to start in five more games in 2003, having many ups and downs. But Tim Couch would once again get another shot to play. He started the last three games, but for the most part was ineffective. The Browns finished the season at 5-11, and they were left with more questions than answers at the quarterback position. Couch's numbers on the season were very pedestrian. He finished with 7 touchdowns and 6 interceptions, while completing 59% of his passes. Holcomb's numbers weren't spectacular either. He finished with 10 touchdowns and 12 interceptions, although his completion percentage was a solid 63. But all signs were pointing to this being the last year of the quarterback controversy. There was a lot of speculation throughout the season that Tim Couch would not return in 2004. All that speculation turned out to be correct. On March 9, 2004, the Browns acquired Pro Bowl quarterback Jeff Garcia from the 49ers, a essentially ending Tim Couch's career in Cleveland. He was subsequently released, and it was a new beginning for Couch. Unfortunately, he was never able to find a long-term landing spot after Cleveland. He would make many attempts at a comeback, but nothing ever panned out, and he officially retired in 2007. So this takes me to my question at the beginning of this video. What is Tim Couch's legacy in the NFL? Is he simply a bust? Before I answer that, let's review his full body of work. Couch finished his NFL career with 64 touchdowns and 67 interceptions, with a completion percentage just under 60. His record as a starter was 22-37. Those aren't great numbers overall, but they aren't horrible either. Now here are some other statistics that should be pointed out. He started all 16 games in 2001, and like I said earlier, he's still the only Browns quarterback to do that since 1999. He led the Browns to the playoffs in 2002. Again, the only Browns quarterback to do that since 99. He had two walk-off Hail Marys. Most quarterbacks will be lucky enough to have that happen once in their career, let alone twice. And perhaps the most impressive stat of them all was his record against Pittsburgh. Tim Couch had a 3-4 record against the Steelers, and a few of those losses were very close games. When you consider how badly the Steelers have dominated the Browns since 99, it becomes an even more impressive stat. So back to the question, was Tim Couch a bust? In the technical sense, yes, he was a bust. He didn't live up to the expectations of a number one pick, and he only lasted 5 seasons with the team that drafted him. But I still refuse to label him a bust. When you consider all the challenges he was faced with, whether it was a lack of supporting talent, or the injuries that plagued him throughout his entire career, he had about as good of a 5-year run as any quarterback in his position would have had. Now obviously you can say a Tom Brady or a Peyton Manning would have been able to have more success than Couch did, but those are Hall of Famers we are talking about. I think most quarterbacks in Tim Couch's position would have produced similar results. As most people have already said, had Couch been put in a better position, I think his career would have turned out a lot differently than it did. I'm not saying he would have been the next Joe Montana, but I think he could have at least been a successful starter for many years. I always used a comparison to Alex Smith. Alex Smith was also a former number one overall pick, who for all intents and purposes didn't live up to expectations, but he still managed to have a pretty good career. Though Alex Smith is a notch below the elite level quarterbacks, he can still put up good numbers and lead you to the playoffs year in and year out. So there you have it. That's my final verdict on Tim Couch. Unfortunately for Cleveland, the Tim Couch story would end up being just one of countless stories about quarterbacks who tried to save the Browns. But what is it about Tim Couch that makes him different? Why are people so enamored with him, and why is he still talked about today? It's because he was the first. He was the first chosen one that was supposed to lead us to the promised land. It's also because he took us on an emotional roller coaster. There were so many ups and downs. From going 2-14 his rookie season, to making the playoffs just 3 years later. And what makes his career even more fascinating is you can't easily sum it up. What I mean by that is you can't say he was a flat-out bust, but you can't say he was a success either. It's hard to say what he was, because he flirted with both sides of the spectrum. But at the end of the day, Tim Couch's time in Cleveland can be a lesson for all of us. And that is to always look back with no regret. It's obvious Tim Couch has done that with his NFL career, because despite not achieving his ultimate goal, he stated many times that he still loves Cleveland and looks back on his time here with fond memories. Well, Tim, likewise. Browns fans appreciate everything you did while you were here. We know you gave it everything you had, and for that, we say thank you. Because until 2018, you were the closest thing we had to a franchise quarterback since the Browns came back in 99. And for the longest time, those first 2 seasons with Butch Davis were joked about as the glory years, but for good reason actually. Those 2 years were a lot of fun, and they are memories that will last a lifetime. So once again, we say thank you.
And that concludes this Tim Couch retrospective. I'd like to thank Toledo Seahawks for the video suggestion. You know, when I saw that suggestion, like a light bulb just went off in my head because I realized I don't think there's one video about Tim Couch on YouTube, like from a content creator. And that's really surprising. I'm sure there'll be copycats after this. But, you know, the Cleveland Browns family or the Cleveland Browns community is a tight-knit group. So I'm sure Tim Couch is going to see this video. And Tim, if you are watching this, I'd really like to know what you think. Did you like it? Do you think I left anything out? I'd really like to get your input. You can respond on Twitter or you can leave a comment below if you have a YouTube account. I'd also like to hear from the rest of you. Please leave comments talking about Tim Couch or this video, whatever. And yeah, that's going to wrap this up. As always, I thank you for watching and please subscribe.